coming up on Need to Know. It appears that we're starting to see evidence of new life in what was once a household name in the photography business. A look at Kodak's Eastman Business Park, the priorities, the partnerships, and the changes on the way. Also on the show, South Sudan is celebrating its fourth birthday this month. But independence festivities have been marred by ongoing conflicts and economic instability. We revisit and examine the work of two Rochester-based organizations providing education and basic needs to the young nation. They say their work is needed now more than ever. Stay with us. It's all coming up right now on Need to Know. Innovation lives here. That's a tagline for Kodak's Eastman Business Park. The company is on the road to reinvention as it transitions away from its traditional revenue stream, film manufacturing. If you were near Eastman Business Park last weekend, here's a scene that may be familiar to you.
Fire in the hole!
Part of Building 53, which was used to make acetate film base, was taken down through an implosion at the business park near Lake Avenue. The Technology Center and Industrial Complex is taking on a new role, new partnerships, and eventually new leadership. Joining me to discuss what this all means for Kodak is Kelly Mandarano, Director of Communications and Campaigns at Eastman Kodak. And welcome. It's great to have you here.
Thank you very much. It's great to be here.
So Randy Gorbin, the news director at XXI, says to me every time he turns around, he feels like recently that he's covering a story about Eastman Business Park, whether it's a new partnership or new venture. So I want to know, how do you describe the current state of the business park in this new era post-bankruptcy?
Sure. Well, the park was built in the late 1890s, and it grew exponentially over the decades to encompass just miles of buildings, machinery, infrastructure. And as Kodak's film business evolved, you know, what we're looking to do is really repurpose the core of that, what we call the industrial tissue of the site. So not just floor space or not just, you know, storage or office space, but to say what Kodak was really great at was not just making film, but the ability to make film.
Right.
And what does that mean? It means chemistry. It means the ability to put layers of chemistry on a thin substrate in a roll-to-roll manufacturing fashion. How does that apply to different categories today? That's what we really tried to look at about 4 years ago when we really dug into this strategy of looking at what you might consider the innovation economy. So energy, biomaterials, how do people make touchscreen panels, you know, personal devices. And then recently, we're really looking at a new category in the agriculture and food production area. Why does that make sense for us? If you think about what does it take to make a battery, there are films in batteries, ultracapacitors, fuel cells. There's a lot of commonality in the technology underpinning that's needed to make those new products. For biomaterials, they need a tremendous access to water, which we have. We have water treatment facilities. We have 17 miles of railway. We have a specialty chem department on site that you can toll with them, so people can take their processes and utilize our scientists. And so in those areas, and then with touchscreen, there's a lot of silver halide technology that was used in film that we're using in certain applications now with our partner Kingsbury. And then we have another technology that utilizes copper plating. So that's an additive where the silver halide is a subtractive. But we're really looking at new applications for what we did great for decades, which was take high-tech capabilities and turn that into the greatest products.
And in looking at these new technologies, you're essentially opening your doors then to new businesses to come in. And I read an article recently, and it called Eastman Business Park the startup landlord. And I don't know if that's what you would call yourselves or if that's part of the vision in all of this. Would it be?
Yeah, you bet. We now have 58 tenants and owners on site. We have right around 6,000 employees. 4,800 of those are non-Kodak employees.
Okay.
So we have a lot of what we might call anchor tenants, like Ledestri Foods, like Carestream. But we also are really targeting that startup segment where we have seen a lot of companies that have an invention or they have innovated a new, say it's a new solar cell. But creating that and making it work in the lab and making a product at scale, very different things. And so we've had a lot of great conversations with the federal government, with the state government, about what they see as that gap between investing in invention upstream in the labs and the incubators and how to create products and jobs at the far end. It's a gap.
And how does it benefit these startups? Why come to Eastman Business Park?
Sure. Well, we have what we're estimating like $100 million worth of equipment that we are making available to external tolling models. So if somebody wants to come in and utilize one of our machines where they can test, they can pilot like a coating of an emulsion that they created, they don't have to buy that machine. They don't have to hire the people that know how to run that machine. And so it really reduces their risk. It increases their predictability. And you think it's not just, so again, it's not just the building and it's not just the machine. It's the staff, the employees that have been there, you know, cumulatively for 100 plus years, you know, and they know how to do that, and it's a great value to these startup companies.
Retiring director Michael Ault of the Business Park, he said real job growth will come when these companies come in, and you mentioned more than 6,000 people are currently working out of Eastman Business Park. What, in terms of a realistic growth with employees, what do you foresee, what do you think is realistic growth in terms of new job opportunities available?
Sure. Well, where we're going to see the real growth is when some of these smaller companies get to operations and manufacture. That's where you see the mid-skill level jobs, the manufacturing jobs, that really, that kind of starts to be a multiplier there. So it's everybody wins once they get beyond where they're working on the prototyping stage. So what we're hopeful that, you know, as we kind of build this pipeline, that we're going to start to see a few breakthrough that crossroads and really get to an operational point where true jobs creation is going to happen.
And Kelly, in building that pipeline, is Eastman Business Park actively pursuing outside companies or business partnerships, whether outside of the state, outside of the country?
Oh, you bet, you bet. We have, you know, several new announcements that we are hoping to make in coming weeks. We have a company that just announced, Cigna Chem, which is actually where Mike is going.
Right.
My dear colleague and friend, he will be retiring from Kodak after 35 years and taking on a new role with this startup company that is in the energy sector. And so he becomes a tenant, actually.
Got it.
So we have, we're really, like I said, we're focused on energy. We've got a lot of battery opportunities. The thing is, we're, you know, on the bio side, we've got a couple of announcements that we're hoping to make soon. We have one that was publicly supported by the state last year. This is a fermentation center.
Okay.
So this is to make a long story short, is taking biomaterials or feedstock. So that could be the non-food parts of corn, corn stover, like the stalks. It could be woody pulp, bringing that in and sending it through a process where third-party companies can come in and add their technology, like a microbe, like a bug, and that turns the output into a biochemical, a biofuel, bioplastic, you know, more of a high-value output. So again, in that instance, it's companies that don't have to invest in that type of infrastructure, but it's more of a tolling system.
Lots of opportunities for growth, for sure. And I appreciate your time, Kelly Mandarano, for joining me. Thank you. And for continued coverage on developments at Kodak and some of the new announcements that Kelly mentioned, be sure to tune in to WXXINews.org. 4 years ago this month, South Sudan celebrated its first Independence Day. It meant the end of a 22-year civil war with the Arab North. You may remember WXXI's continued coverage leading up to the event as former Lost Boys of Sudan living in Rochester return home to join their family members for the festivities. But 4 years later, the struggle for freedom continues. For more than a year and a half, a civil war within South Sudan, launched by political strife, has killed thousands of people, displaced hundreds of thousands, and left the economy in disarray. And while news broadcasts around the world show few signs of hope at the moment, members of our local South Sudanese community say hope does exist. And they add that Rochester efforts supporting the world's youngest nation are needed now more than ever. Joining me to discuss the current state of one of those efforts we've documented on Need to Know involving education, building minds in South Sudan, is the organization's co-founder and president, Sebastian Morondi. Also joining the conversation is Linda Wirtz of the Newark Rotary Club. And Linda has worked with Sebastian in South Sudan. And welcome to both of you.
Thank you.
So viewers got to learn about the Ajang Primary School built in your hometown, Mayenabun, through our Schools for South Sudan series here on Need to Know. And I want to know, how is the school being impacted by the current conflict?
Well, schools have survived the conflict, and thank God we are 4 hours away, plane from the same South Sudan regions. We are a bit lucky and fortunate that the school still exists and running as smoothly. But we are not happy that some part of the country, the conflict still exists, and children there don't have access to school. And we hope that we can create more access to all those children, including girls.
So the Ajang school is fairly isolated then from the violence.
From
and you're
the
saying
violence,
it's several hours away and it has not touched the village at all.
Not at all. But the conflict is taking place at the east side of the Nile, and we are at the west side of the Nile.
The conflict had began about 18 months ago between the president and the former vice president. And Sebastian, in your own words, how would you describe what the fighting is about, and are you optimistic that it will end soon?
To my understanding, culturally, the fighting was not a tribal war. It is very much a power struggle between the former vice president and the current president. And I hope that that will come to an end this year. That's my hope, because we don't want to see these children running again to hide, walking like us when we were children. We want to see young girls going to school.
And some of the impact of it would be kids are being pulled out of school and regions and parts where this is the violence is located, pulled out of school, or they're being forced to drop out of school as a means of safety.
Yeah.
Linda, you have traveled with Sebastian. You visited the Ajang school. You were involved in the Pads for Girls initiative, mm-hmm. which introduced young women and older women to washable and reusable sanitary products, which really was a game changer, because before, these young women couldn't go to school when they were on their menstrual cycle. They would have to miss classes. Talk about your experience, and because I understand from Sebastian that there's more that you want to do, and you have more plans. So what was it about your experience that would make you say, there's so much more that we can be doing?
Well, I think just learning about South Sudan in 2012, I had met a woman before, and then I had a chance to meet Sebastian, and just learning about the needs that are existent in this country, this very young nation, really, it's just, it's a place to put our efforts. And being there and experiencing the girls, the boys at the school, the women, it just, it makes you really want to reach out and help. I mean, we talk about the sanitary pads there. I mean, it's unbelievable for, and a lot of African women have no access to that. So in order to start bring this into their lives and make it a little micro industry where they could then produce them and with sewing machines that we provided and materials and a little bit of money, they could then, I think they're into making other sewing. It's more of a cottage industry now.
So right now they're producing their own,
and maybe additionally clothing. Yeah. I mean, it's a little cottage industry, and it's a wonderful thing to be able to know you've had a part in that.
Yeah. I want to point out, because the Zhang School complex is fully built. So this is a change from the last time that you were here. It's fully built. We're talking 8 classrooms, 3 latrines for students and teachers. There's a women's center, and more than 800 students are taking classes.
817 students.
817. And you're also offering teacher training through these Skype sessions with professors here in the U.S., but there's more. And you told me that you have plans for...
We are planning to include 4 American universities to work together with South Sudan University to train not only our school, but schools around Warabi State, which is where our school is built.
Right.
In addition to that, we wanted to build a girls' school.
So a girls' school is the new plan for building my Sudan
so far. January 2016, I will go to South Sudan and will be joined hopefully by Linda from Newark Rotary Club and the other group from within the board of directors to go and have a groundbreaking to build a new school that will include all the girls, regardless of their cultural background, their tribal background. Because South Sudan have a high rate of domestic violence against women, and this has to change. Through this school, it will change.
And I want to point out, just so viewers know, that the Zhang Primary School includes males and females in terms of the student body. Nicholas Kristof, a journalist, well-known journalist, recently wrote an op-ed for the New York Times talking about education in South Sudan. Schools created by former Lost Boys, building mines in South Sudan was mentioned, as was water for South Sudan. And he was talking about this pivotal role of education that we may not fully process in terms of what it can mean in the nation. How would you describe it so people can really grasp it?
Well, in that region where the tribal culture prevents girls, if you are a girl in South Sudan, especially in Nilotic community, that including Dinka and Nuer, you are seen as a product because parents will get cows from your husband. So for you to have a chance to go to school, it's not easy. So by creating a girls' school, a separate school only for girls, will help us to drive in more girls. Recently, when I visited South Sudan, I had a discussion on their local radio saying that an educated girls will bring in more cows. I didn't mean it in my heart. What I meant was let them get education, and afterward, they will fight for their own freedom.
What type of response did you get from that interview?
Well, they were... What do you mean by saying it will bring more cows? Do you have a different agenda? I said, no, I don't have a different agenda. I wanted to have them get education. If a country is chi, if a country is a female, why not give a woman a chance to get an education? Because there's no, country is not he. Country is chi. And South Sudan is chi. And so the women are the nation.
Linda, in terms of what you plan, the work that you're doing right now, I understand you're seeking grant funding. What plans do you have in terms of helping building mines in South Sudan kind of further its vision?
Well, I plan to just stay actively involved in promoting Sebastian's goals and visions. I mean, when I was there and talking with the girls and talking with some of the others in the country, they have a strong vision to pull themselves out of poverty and to make themselves a very substantial nation. And they only need a little help. And so I'm working with Rotary right now. We are involved in a big grant, a global grant, which would involve education, water for South Sudan, and also working with a health clinic that's there in the area, I think, also. bringing solar energy, solar power into that health clinic and perhaps into the schools that would facilitate this interchange between the professors and universities. So,
well, Sebastian, I know you told me that in the past it's baby steps, and certainly you're taking those steps, and we look forward to seeing more growth and catching up with you after this groundbreaking ceremony. So to Linda Wirtz and Sebastian Maroney, I appreciate both of your time, and thanks for joining me today.
Thank you.
And you can learn more about ongoing and future projects being led by Building Minds in South Sudan. Go to their website, bmiss.org. And from building schools to digging borehole wells, we now look into the work of Rochester-based Water for South Sudan. The nonprofit, founded by former Lost Boy Salva Dute, has drilled to date more than 250 water wells throughout South Sudan. According to UNICEF, 32% of the population in the country doesn't have access to clean water. As I learned during my visit to South Sudan, if there's a well, there are endless possibilities. Schools can be built, vegetables can grow, a market can thrive, and much more. I recently sat down with Salva Dute and Angelique Stevens of Water for South Sudan, and they discussed their recent work and explained how digging wells in the midst of conflict has a significant meaning.
South Sudan is the newest country in the world, and right now it's in the process of building infrastructure. And in that process, there has been some fighting at the political level between the two tribes. And Water for South Sudan, I think, acts as a great model for peace. And they're not only working towards peace with two tribes that have been historically against each other, but they're working to build infrastructure in a country that's desperately trying to rebuild after years and years of war.
We have a great collaboration with other Lost Boy young man. He's been doing some good work too in Nebraska. And he's from Nuer tribe, and I'm from Dinka tribe. And what we do is to go from this tribe to go and put the well there, and then go to another place and put the well there. When we go there, we are always welcome. They never think that I'm from different tribe, or Bowie, the other guy from Nuer tribe. When he comes to Dinka area, they don't think that it's a Nuer, why he's here and all this kind of thing. They just say, it's our brother. And also too, it's a good example for our people that, especially the tribal that keep killing each other all the time because they don't think this tribe deserve what. It's a good example to show them that we can work together no matter what. And also too, it's kind of like setting up the democracy for them to understand the democracy too, for making sure people work together and you share equally. No one can take advantage of one another.
We've been drilling for 10 years, and we decided this is a perfect time to go back and see if our wells are doing well. We had read a report a few years ago that said a lot of money had been wasted on boreholes in the whole of Africa. South Sudan is a small country. So we wanted to make sure that we weren't part of that statistic. And so I went back for 2 months to go to a number of villages to just see, are our wells still working? You know, are the communities still benefiting from them? And what we found is that they are. We had hoped to visit about 25 to 40 wells. We visited 80. We learned that all of the wells that we've drilled in villages, when they break, because they break down a number of times. The communities were given enough training, enough resources from our drilling crew when they first went in to be self-sustainable enough to either fix their well on their own or to know where to go to get the resources to fix it. We tested for 11 contaminants in a sampling of the 80 wells that we saw, and in all of the wells that we tested for, all of the responses came out in safe numbers for the well. So, you know, E. coli and coliform, those are the biggest things, and they were all safe for drinking. One of the reasons why wells didn't do so well in that report for all of Africa is that power was an issue. The well became a source of power. So tribes would come, they would blow up a well, they would maybe take it over and start selling the resource. One of the questions we asked was, does everybody have equal access to the well? And in every village we went to, people would get angry. What kind of question is that? Why would you ask such a question? And Lyon, who was our director for East Africa Operations, said, do we have to keep asking this question? I feel so bad. And I said, yes. I mean, it's even more reason to ask the question, because it's important to know if that is one of the issues. And it's just not. One of the things that we did learn is the first step is water. And the second step, Salva saw last year, which was very important, is hygiene. You're in places where there's no soap and where people have for hundreds of years not washed their hands or those sorts of things. And so Salva implemented a hygiene program last year. This is our
second year.
We have a full team that goes out. They train hygiene practices to about 8 people. Some of them are young, some of them are old, boys, both boys and girls. And their job is to disseminate what they learned to the rest of the village.
That well is not just a drinking water only. They are using that well to build their houses too, like make a wall out of that.
The stick and mud hut, which is the tukul that's very common in South Sudan. And that mud hut has to be remade, the mud part, every 2 years, and the straw on the top, sometimes every year. And that's a lot of remaking. But when there is water, they can make real bricks. They can kiln those bricks, fire them up, and they're much stronger.
There are so many challenges in that, especially doing the work in the world that has no infrastructure completely. Is not that easy. It's not like here when you are driving and you feel hungry, you can stop at McDonald's and then drive through the window and get the food. It's not like that. If you have a breakdown, you call AAA and then they come and tell you. It's not like that. We have anything that we have to carry it with us. If we need to eat, we have to stop in the middle of wilderness and then cook for hours before we move on. Those are the challenges that we got. But because we are changing lives, whatever suffering challenges we're going to get is going to produce a good result. Sometimes we cannot predict the world fully, but when you start something small, that might trigger the other one.
You can find out more about the United Peace and Development Project and upcoming work by Water for South Sudan on their website. Check out waterforsouthsudan.org. And that's it for this edition of Need to Know. I'm Helene B. and Duty Hofer. Thank you for joining me tonight and throughout the weekend. I'll see you next week right here on WXXI TV.